Welcome to the Star Gallery. Here, you can see red dwarfs and blue giants. We have stars that will blind you with their glow. And the shy ones, which are hard to notice in the swarm. With some of them, you'll catch a good suntan. While with others, you could catch a cold.
Bless you.
Bless you. Here, we have young stars that are just gathering their followers. And the ones that already have many stories to tell. And their stories are spectacular.
On every clear night, we can visit the prettiest star exhibition. All we have to do is move away from the bright city lights and look up. The entrance is free. All we need is good eyesight and curiosity. And the repertoire mostly depends on the season. In order to ease our navigation through the crowded sky, we group the stars into constellations, imaginary shapes we get when we connect the dots. During the idyllic winter, we enjoy ourselves under shiny Orion. That's the time when it's located opposite the sun on our celestial sphere, which means we see it at night. In the summer, he shares the sky with the sun. That is, he sneaks across the sky during the day, and we cannot see him in his full glory until our new winter get-togethers. Constellations that hang around the North Celestial Pole decorate our sky throughout the year. We call them the Northern Circumpolar Constellations. The most famous among them is the Ursa Major constellation. That is, its small part, the Big Dipper. A group of stars that creates a recognizable shape but isn't officially recognized as a constellation, we call an asterism. Not so far away from there is the Ursa Minor constellation, which carries Polaris at the end of its tail. Since it is very close to the northern celestial pole, from our perspective, it seems that all the constellations dance around the Ursa Minor. Circumpolar constellations of the south celestial pole are visible to us only if we take a tour to the southern regions, meaning that the star repertoire is bound not only by the season, but by our location too. Celestial tales were listened to and passed on by our ancestors as well, whose voices were almost lost in the vastness of time. The images from the Lascaux Cave in France, created almost 20,000 years ago, probably show one of the first maps of the sky. These dots share an uncanny resemblance with the Pleiades, which means that this dot could be Aldebaran from the zodiac constellation Taurus. This is at least one of the possible interpretations. But cultures that followed continued to observe the celestial occurrences. Along with the mythological aspect of ancient astronomy, the practical one is also important. Understanding the stars, specifically constellations and their positions in the sky, enables us to measure the passing of time. Do you remember Orion and the idyllic winter? The more and more it towers over our heads, the warmer are the jackets we are wearing. Okay, you're right. This is a bit less precise than the calendars on our phone, computer, or our desk. But if we don't have a phone, a computer, or a desk, well, we have to start from someplace. In Homer's Odyssey, the main hero finds his way through the Mediterranean thanks to the guidance of the stars. Gladly, Odysseus spread out his sails to catch the wind and started to practice astronomy. The Pleiades are mentioned, the Bootes constellation, even the bear, quote, which circles in one place and marks Orion. This is Homer's way to tell us how the constellation Ursa Minor is circumpolar, and the little bear constantly keeps an eye on the dangerous hunter, Orion. Quote, Calypso, queen of the goddesses, had told him to keep the bear on his left side while sailing. The stars guided the medieval explorers through their ocean quests, but without the help of Calypso, queen of the goddesses. We rely on stars in our space travels too. Spacecraft Voyager, by which we visited the outer planets of the solar system, orient themselves with the help of instruments that track the positions of shiny stars, the sun, and, in Voyager 2's case, Canopus, the jewel of the southern celestial hemisphere. Today, we translate celestial tales using the language of science. We measure the distance of the stars, we study their structure, and discover the planets that follow them. We stop perceiving stars as an eternal and unchanging decoration above our heads. We already know that they are born, live their lives, and grow old. Deep inside their cores, they transform chemical elements by nuclear fusion. And eventually, they die. The most massive stars will end their lives in an explosion we call the supernova. It can pierce the fabric of the universe itself and create a gap in space-time, a black hole nothing can escape, not even light. That is a story for another time. With its explosion, a star sends an abundance of chemical elements into the universe, which, in time, become the main parts of new stars, planets, and even ourselves. In the words of the astronomer Carl Sagan, we are made of star stuff. We are a way for the cosmos to know itself. Taught by the lessons from history, aided by science and technology, and driven by curiosity, if not necessity, one day, our descendants will sail among the stars. At the first stop, the star closest to us, Proxima Centauri and her planetary suite, the Sun is just a bright dot in the Cassiopeia constellation, one amongst many. The ones that will go even further will, gradually, completely lose sight of their ancestors' home. And in doing so, they will find a new home among the stars. For them, the voices of our generations will only be an echo of the times long gone, as far and as mysterious as the voices of the artist astronomers from Lascaux are to us. Where will all the celestial tales take the